So here we have a 3x3 matrix, not a very creative one, but it is an interesting one because the question, is it an invertible, turns out to be an answer of no, though you wouldn't necessarily know that just from looking at it. The quickest way to answer that question is to compute its determinant and to see that the determinant ends up being zero. If it's not zero, then it would be invertible. But if it is zero, it's not invertible. And then, hey, we don't have to do the second question. Though I do want to show you what would happen if you tried to do it by trying to find A inverse. You find determinants in a couple different ways. The most common way is called a cofactor expansion, where you're thinking about expanding about certain rows or certain columns and computing subdeterminants. If you haven't read about this, that might be confusing. I'll show you what to do. If you've got zeros in the matrix, it's good to choose a row or column that's got the most zeros to do your cofactor expansion about, because it reduces the amount of work you have to do. But in this case, we don't have any zeros, so you might as well just pick the first row to do your cofactor expansion across. And how do you do it? You don't have to circle it. I did. I circled that first row. I take the first number in that first row, which does happen to be a 1, and write it down. And I multiply that by the determinant of a 2x2 matrix obtained by imagining canceling out that row and canceling out that column that the 1 is in. It's in the first row and the first column. Imagine deleting those. If you delete those, you're left with a 2x2 matrix. I take that number, that 1, and multiply it by the determinant of that 2x2 submatrix, which I can use DET notation for, though it's a little quicker to use absolute value notation, which also means determinant. However, careful, it's not an absolute value, it's a determinant. It can be negative. In fact, this one will be. It'll be 5 times 9 is 45, minus 8 times 6, 45, minus 48, it'll be negative 3. That is going to be a negative number. 2x2 matrices, you compute the determinant, just like I said, multiply the numbers in the main diagonal and subtract the product of the numbers in the off diagonal. 45 minus 48, negative 3. Then you go to the next number in the first row, the 2, and write it down with a minus sign. The sign has to alternate. That's just the way it works. Who thought of these determinants in the first place? I think it might have been Laplace in the early 1700s who thought about these things. It's a problem-solving thing to come up with this idea of a determinant. Anyway, we're just going to do it. That's in the first row and second column. Delete the first row and second column. You're left with a 2x2 submatrix, 4, 6, 7, 9. Multiply by the determinant of that submatrix. Again, using quote-unquote absolute value notation, but it's not really an absolute value. It's a determinant. You can tell because it's a matrix. This could, once again, be negative, is it? 4 times 9 is 36. 7 times 6 is 42. Yeah, 36 minus 42 is negative 6. That is negative. You do have a negative sign there just because that's the method. The signs alternate plus, minus, plus, minus. If you got a plus, minus, plus in this case, if you got a 4x4 matrix, they alternate plus, minus, plus, minus. Though it gets tricky if you go about other rows besides the first one, and the alternating in sign could start with a negative sign. I'm not giving you details because I want to focus on the main ideas here. Then you go to the last entry in that row. It's a 3. Make sure that's a plus sign. It's alternating again, plus, minus, plus. Multiply by the determinant of the submatrix there, 4, 5, 7, 8. And that is going to be, once again, negative. How about that? 32 minus 35, that'll be a negative 3. Doesn't always happen that those are negative. So we get negative 3, minus 2 times negative 6 will be plus 12, and then plus 3 times negative 3 will be minus 9. Yes, we do get 0. This determinant is 0. That means A is not invertible. Non-invertible matrices are sometimes called singular matrices. It's a little confusing. Non-invertible means singular. Invertible means non-singular. They're called singular matrices because they're kind of rare. it's like a singularity. It's a rare kind of thing to get a determinant of zero, but it does happen to be the case here. Question?
But we have to find that each one of the matrix larger than 2 by 3 on the determinant?
No, I won't be doing it larger than 3 by 3. Theoretically, it's possible you could do 4 by 4 or 5 by 5, but it gets to be a real, real big pain. But what would happen if we tried answering this question by trying to find A inverse? Let's go ahead and see. You want to make an augmented matrix with A being, in this case, since it's 3 by 3, being the first three columns. And the identity 3 by 3 matrix being the matrix that's the next part, the next set of three columns. Oops, don't make that mistake that I almost made. There is an identity matrix, 3 by 3 identity matrix, I. And then you do row operations to try to get into reduced row echelon form. And if the part over on the left becomes the identity matrix when you do so, then the part right there is A inverse. But since A inverse doesn't exist here, evidently we will not get the identity matrix here. We'll get maybe three zeros there, there, and there. To emphasize something else, I'm going to do something weird. Okay, you do not have to do this on the exam, probably, or at least not in this context. I'm going to make this a doubly augmented matrix, huh? I'm going to add an A, B, and C over here. Why? Because I'd like to find the image of the corresponding linear transformation, that's why. I'd like to know, are the conditions on A, B, and C that are going to allow me to solve the resulting system of equations, kind of ignoring the part in the middle there. Is this allowed? Can I do it? Sure, if I feel like it. You won't ever have to do this. Just making it harder on myself. Okay. It's nice to make the keep the upper left number being a 1 because I don't have to change the first row here. Okay, I'm going to multiply row 1 by negative 4 and add it to row 2. Put the answer in row 2 to get a 0 right there. We can do this pretty quickly, I think. 2 times negative 4 is negative 8, plus 5 is negative 3. 3 times negative 2 is negative 6 plus, or negative 4, excuse me. 3 times negative 4 is negative 12, plus 6 is negative 6. Keep going. 1 times negative 4 is negative 4, plus 0 is negative 4. 0 times negative 4 is 0. Add 0 to 1, still get a 1. Still get a 0 here. A times negative 4 is negative 4a, plus b is negative 4a plus b. Almost out of paper there. In my doubly augmented matrix. Okay, I'll also multiply row 1 by negative 7 and add it to row 3 to get a 0 here. Negative 7 times 2 is negative 14, plus 8 is negative 6. Negative 7 times 3 is negative 21, plus 9 is negative 12. Oh, yeah, these two rows, if you ignore everything else, are now multiples of each other. You're going to get zeros here, here, and here on the next step. Negative 7 times 0 is still 0. Or negative 7 times 1, excuse me, is negative 7, plus 0 is negative 7. Here I get a 0. Here I still stay with a 1. Here I get negative 7a plus c. Let's keep the first row the same. I'm going to multiply row 2 by negative 1/3 to get a 1 right there. A 2 right there, a positive 4/3 right here, a negative 1/3, a 0, and negative 1/3 times this will be positive 4/3 A minus 1/3 B. And then, however you want to think about it, maybe if you go back up here, multiplying row 2 by negative 2, to get a 6 there and adding it to this one to get a 0 there, I'm also going to get a 0 there. I'll get two zeros here and here. That right enough, right there is enough to say A is not invertible. The fact that I got three zeros there. This left part is not going to row reduce to the identity matrix. right there, I can say A is not invertible. Should I keep going though? I think I'd like to keep going for the purpose of figuring out the image. Does that mean I need to figure out what goes here, here, and here? Just to play it safe, maybe I should. I'll go back up here. Multiply this row by -2 and add it to row 3. Put the answer in row 3. -2 times -4 is +8. Plus -7 is +1. -2 times 1 is -2. Plus 0 is -2. That's a 0, so that 1's not going to change. Okay, it's a little tricky here. -2 times -4a is +8a. Plus -7a is +a. -2 times b is -2b plus c is -2b plus c. Okay, I can stop here. I don't have to go completely to reduced row echelon form. If I were going to completely take this 3x7 matrix and go, 3x7 matrix and go to reduced row echelon form, I'd want to get zeros here and here, and also there above the leading ones. But I don't have to even answer the last question, because the key thing to making this system consistent, if I ignore this middle part and just focus on this part over here, for the original system to be consistent, to have a solution, that thing has got to equal zero. If this is non-zero, then you got an inconsistent equation. Zero equals something non-zero. So really the image of the corresponding linear transformation is defined to be, if I think of this as a vector A, B, C, the vector, all set of all vectors A, B, C, satisfying the condition that A minus 2B plus C is zero. Can that be visualized? Yeah, and you've learned how. This is equivalent to the dot product of the vector 1, negative 2, 1 with the vector A, B, C equaling 0. And that means 1, negative 2, 1 is a normal vector to this plane. This equation defines a plane in 3 space. And there's a vector that's normal to it, the coefficients of the A, the B, and the C. So if you're going to try to draw this plane with X coming out of the screen at you, Y going this way, and Z going this way, you'd want to draw that normal vector first. X is 1, Y is negative 2, Z is 1. It's got to kind of go to the left here and kind of come out of the screen at you. Which means, since that's perpendicular to the plane itself has kind of got to look like this. That plane, I guess I should have labeled my axes A, B, and C, but it's not a big deal. That plane can be thought of as the image of the corresponding linear transformation. All the outputs you're going to get when you apply A times X are going to be vectors that, if you put their tails at the origin, will be parallel to this plane that is perpendicular to this blue vector. So the blue vector is coming out of the screen at you. The plane is kind of going like that. Some people find three-dimensional visualization fairly easy. Some people find it exceedingly difficult. I don't know who you are, if you find it easy or difficult. I'm somewhere in between. I can kind of visualize it in my head, but I have a hard time drawing it. Probably most people have a hard time drawing it. But this is the algorithm. Ignore that part. That is the algorithm for finding an inverse when it exists, is take your original matrix and the identity matrix, do your row operations to reduce row echelon form. If this becomes the identity matrix, then whatever is over there is the inverse.